Hi, everybody. Thanks so much for coming out. I am Nick Gillespie, and this is Faisal, Saeed, Mutar, and Melissa Chen. It should be Melissa, but
hi.
Don't talk yet. So we are going to be recording the Reason interview with these two guys. They co-founded 5 years ago a nonprofit called Ideas Beyond Borders. And their basic thing that they started out doing was translating books about pluralism, science, civil liberties, and critical thinking. And I'm talking about books like John Stuart Mill's On Liberty and Steven Pinker's Enlightenment Now into Arabic. And then they distribute them for free as ebooks throughout the Arabic-speaking world. They've also translated thousands of Wikipedia pages on the same topics and made them available to an audience desperately interested in new ways of thinking about culture, politics, and ideas. Faisal left Iraq after extremists killed his brother and threatened his life. And Melissa was once a persona non grata in her native Singapore due to her activism there. They're going to explain how they work to prevent extremism and cancel culture in the West as well as the East. Ideas Beyond Borders is also actively helping Afghans find refuge from the Taliban and is running a global campaign against censorship at endbannedbooks.org, which I highly recommend you check out. So without further ado, Faisal, Melissa, thanks for coming out.
Thanks for having us.
Are you allowed to speak?
I think so.
Okay, yeah. He's not.
It's not the Middle East, Melissa.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Women can speak. Okay.
Okay. It's not even Midtown. So, you know, it's the Lower East, right? Faisal, talk about what was the aha moment when you wanted to create what became Ideas Beyond Borders?
Yeah, I mean, it's like a given concern that I grew up in an environment that forces you to think about the subjects like extremism. And when you see your first beheading, your first reaction is like,
you never forget.
Actually, there's some truth to that.
Yeah.
From like growing up in that kind of an environment that forces you to think, to really try to find solutions to the environment around me. And I privilege in that regard is that I grew up with kind of an educated family. My parents studied in the UK, so I learned English since a young age.
You grew up in Baghdad.
I was born in Babylon, yeah. And I grew up in Baghdad. And so then when
that sounds like a Bob Dylan song, to be
honest. It's a punk rock band, yeah.
How old are you?
So I was born in 1991. So right after the first Gulf War, during the sanctions that the US put on Iraq, and then during the regime of Saddam Hussein, followed by the second Gulf War in 2003. And the other subject that's really what I'm touching on this is the subject of information. I remember growing up, in which me and my dad had to go on the roof listening to the radio that is banned by the Saddam Hussein regime. And it was like the punishment for listening to radio or satellite television is sometimes death. So for me, like the subject of both information and the subject of how to combat extremism is something that was, I would say, forced on me. I think I wanted as a kid to be an astronomer, actually. And then when you hear the first rocket, you're like, shit, I have to take care of what's around here. And here I am.
Yeah. Melissa, talk about how many books has Ideas Beyond Borders translated, and how do you distribute them? I mean, it's one thing to say, you know, you put them out as ebooks and then send them out on the internet, but you know, what does that actually mean?
Well, it's also interesting, like how we actually have to acquire these books, because, you know, we have to negotiate for free Arabic digital rights from the authors involved. And so, you know, we've worked with people like Steven Pinker, Sam Harris, the neuroscientist, all sorts of writers who have done books on science and philosophy, and like the graphic novel that I think it was Atlas Network that did.
Heterodox.
Oh, Heterodox, yeah.
A chapter from right. John Stuart Mill's On Liberty.
Exactly. Just ideas that we know are not represented well in that part of the world in that language. I think that part is very crucial. You know, for so long in the Middle East, you've had censorship because of religious and cultural reasons. And at the end of the day, like, it decimates the publishing industry there because writers learn how to anticipate market pressures. And they know what will happen if books get... I mean, we all saw what happened to Salman Rushdie the moment Ayatollah Khomeini put a fatwa on his book. And I think publishers...
Sales went through the roof.
It did. It went through the roof, as it always does when people try to ban things. But you have, it creates this culture of intimidation, because let's not forget the publishers and translators, that three of them were actually assaulted and killed for simply touching that book in Milan, Oslo, and Tokyo, just from a fatwa, right? Yeah. And so the effects are really pernicious. And if you look at the numbers, a bestseller in the Arabic world runs about like, to be considered a bestseller, you have to sell about 1,000 books per year. But the New York Times, to be a bestseller, it's 5,000 in a week. So that's kind of the disparity that
we're
dealing
with. I know you guys have a statistic about the number of books that are translated into Arabic versus like Spanish. What is that number, to give a sense of kind of how closed off the Arabic language world is from new books?
Yes, that's from the UN Development Report that said there are more books translated to Spanish in 1 year than Arabic in 1,000 years.
Wow.
Hopefully we're changing that, so that statistic is no longer as valid. But I mean, as Melissa was saying, is like you have the authoritarianism, especially after the First World War, where the a lot of rise of Arab nationalism and things like that censored any outside information, followed by the Nazis, who are one of the reasons why you see a lot of Mayan camps and a lot of bookstores around the Middle East. I just actually came back from the Middle East. Is the fact that the Nazi Germany used that kind of region as a battlefield between that and the Allied. And then afterwards, it was the Soviet Union. So you really got the worst both ideologies the world has ever known, communism and Nazism, spreading over there using the translation method. And it was actually one of my happiest moments was seeing Enlightenment Now on the front page of some of the stores that we work with across the Middle East.
And it's ironic, right? Or in a way, you have to negotiate with the authors for the Arabic language rights, but they're kind of willing to give them up, right?
They are, because they know that they won't be able to make a profit in that part in Arabic. Like they just know that. And so most of our books are actually
some of them. We know a bunch of assholes, but yeah.
Oh, that's true. But so our books are all digital, because that's a really easy way to actually subvert censors. Like in the Middle East, you have various governments, like the Kuwaiti government, you know, they all have Ministry of Information, by the way. Like that's just, you know, I mean, up until like what?
I was going to say that.
Up until last week, we didn't have one. Most of the Arab countries have either some sort of Ministry of Culture, Ministry of Information, some sort of moral police. And, you know, they put out just a list of books that, in Kuwait, it's about 5,000 banned books.
They want you to read them, right?
Yeah.
Does it function at all like that? Of, you know, when you have a long list of whatever you do, don't read these books. I'm telling you, not these ones. You can read those ones, these.
It does or it doesn't. I mean, it really depends on how authoritarian some like regimes gets. Mm-hmm. Like in Iraq, like sometimes they used to publicize the killing of people who had satellite television. So when you do that, when you go, again, it's like Saddam Hussein makes a lot of terrorists. He's like he's to call him a bad dictator is an understatement. Like he was a combination of, again, both Nazism and communism and all the bad ideologies combined. So he was willing to go that far.
I also understand he was a Mets fan.
I just learned that. So something I learned. Yeah. So it depends on like how far now in this age, what I think is very beautiful about the 21st century is that this ability to circumvent some of the so in a way it's like IBB is like at the right time at the right place to do the work that we do, because before it was literally people like barely able to smuggle a PlayStation. I remember like growing up, and to smuggle books that are banned, only very selected people are willing to take high risk to actually just do it for that.
Well, to your point, Nick, I will say, because you know he said about he mentioned that whatever is banned is always wanted, which is an Arabic proverb. I always have gum in my mouth because I grew up in a country where this was banned very famously.
You're being
in Singapore.
Very bad right now. Yeah.
So it's just I have a cheek pocket. I don't think I would have liked gum. Yeah. Because, you know, at all, if I had grown up here where it was like readily available, but because it was something I couldn't have, it has always held this mystique for me. And now I have a permanent cheek pocket where I store it.
So do you, what format? Do you put them in PDFs and then people you know, I mean, basically, I mean, do you hide the file under false names and things like that? Or is that giving away too much?
So two, PDF and HTML, so HTML mm-hmm. for faster browsing, low speed internet. And also now we're working with an organization called Bioforest. And what it does is that it mirrors our websites across all the world. So mm-hmm. if the website is banned in one country, it can be allowed in the other. That came in as a result of actually people notifying us that our website has been banned in Egypt and Syria. It's been banned in Syria multiple times, which is kind of a good sign, means you're doing your work.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like we do our best to kind of adapt to the new technologies. I sometimes see our books actually spreading in Signal. So Signal is an app that's heavily now being used, promoted by us a lot across the region, Telegram and stuff like that. So, and that's what I think that the book made it. You mentioned like On Liberty. Mm-hmm. I saw it to like some shady Telegram channel. And I mean, everything is shady on Telegram, yeah. but on that specific thing, it was the shady that I like. And I saw like our book there, like downloaded a couple thousand times. So, mm-hmm. but for what we do is that it's mostly online, and we also take into account that the internet speeds there are not as fast, though, mm-hmm. which our best to make the file smaller and be able to people for there to navigate.
And do you have an ad-free app for this if people want that?
So far, yeah, because we're a non-profit. I mean, right. and the thing is like, we cannot, because as Melissa was saying about the for-profit industry there, it's still very minimal. But in my last visit to the Middle East, I actually see that something really worth mentioning is that how, like what we, many of us here take for granted, like freedom of speech and stuff like that, people there are willing to die for it. And I met with like a book publisher. His dad was killed for selling books. And he's like, this is now the mission of my life, is to actually build a successful business model that actually contains the publishing industry. So I think is that there is definitely the will. And people are willing to put, like when I came to America, I don't want to like talk so much about this, but when I came to America 10 years ago, I thought like these values were already accepted, freedom of speech, the right for publish, all that stuff. And to see Americans shitting on it every day. And then it's like, when you go there, I'm actually reminded of how important these values, because these people are putting their lives on the line for it. And so they are going to be, I believe, like just from my list of conversations, is there's great demand. Mm-hmm. Enlightenment now is actually doing really well, and John Stuart Mill. So there's people are willing to buy the book out of support for the publisher. So I'm hoping that in the next couple of years, and we are supporting them through our micro grant program, etc., to kind of build that seed, and they're able to go on their own, and then there will be no need for us to do our work anymore.
Well, recently, actually, at the Baghdad Book Fair, we had a publisher in Iraq email us.
That was one book, right?
What?
That there was one book at the Baghdad Book Fair?
You'll be surprised, yeah. Actually. Funny. No, but they actually, a publisher actually emailed us and said, you know, we would actually like to print one of your books. And we're like, which one? And it was, believe it or not, it was Sam Harris's End of Faith.
Wow.
Right? And this was like, wow, this was, I'm like, wow, we actually, you know, to have a publisher.
He can
think.
Be the most hated man on every continent now. Right?
Right.
No,
right.
That's fascinating, right. Though. Why do you think that book resonated? Or
I think it's just, you know, If it was up to this publisher to negotiate for the rights, to try to get somebody to translate it, which is expensive, he wouldn't have made a dime. But because IBB had already done it digitally, the translation already existed, all he needed to do was have the balls, and really in that part of the world, that's what it requires, to print the book and to decide to display it and to sell it. And so I see this as really changing the calculus for people, for publishers, a very fledgling, very throttled industry. And you know, this is anachronistic, right? Like, because back then, like, there was a time when the Arabic world was flush with pluralism and you know, while Europe was going through a dark age, the Arabic world was kind of the seed of the Enlightenment. There was a period of time when that was the case, when great libraries, which, by the way, that's what we named our online library after, was a House of Wisdom, which in Arabic is Bayt al-Hikmah, which was a beautiful library that existed in your part of the world, right. Which my people sacked, right?
In my neighborhood, in my hood. Yeah,
the Mongols burned it down. Sorry. And then it never really recovered.
Talk about where do you find your translators, and then how do you compensate them? Because this is not an easy task. I mean, Melissa, you were talking about some of the translators of Rushdie's The Satanic Verses were killed, were attacked and killed. Obviously, you are sourcing the translation mostly in the Middle East,
all
right?
Of it,
so
yes.
Yeah. So how do you protect them? How do you pay them and things like that?
We have I think one day hopefully a documentary will be made on our work. But really, we use a very kind of anonymous protected system in which we send the money to one country in the Middle East that gets sent to other countries. And then when people pick the money, they don't have to show any identification for them to receive it. Mm-hmm. So in that way, so even sometimes we deal is like we tell them, oh, this guy is going to show up at 3 p.m., come pick up the money, and this person shows up without any actually knowledge about what this money is about. What we're utilizing on is that kind of the expat community that a lot of people like live in Germany who send their money back to their families in Syria or in Iraq and stuff like that. So this we communicated that this is kind of another way. It's like, oh, my cousin is sending my money from Germany. So far, it's working. However, I think the now there are some technologies being evolved in Signal and other places that might be we also utilize, because that's in a way faster, in a way less reliant. Most of these systems are reliant on a lot of trust. What happens is that you need to have a lot of people who believe in the mission, willing to take a risk in their life to actually do the work that we do. The question is, I always try to reduce that friction of how to allow that. In terms of how we pick many of these people, I mean, there is a very, as I said, like a growing movement of people who have tried all forms of authoritarianism. They have lived under socialism. They have lived under Islamic, ISIS, and the likes. And they're like, fuck it. We need something else. When I'm back to Iraq, they call me like the founding father of that kind of movement, even though I was like younger at the time, because we were the crazies when we were 15 and 16. And the thing is that movement, after 13 years coming back to my home country, it was just so amazing to see that this movement that we started actually now have hundreds of thousands. And many of them actually adopted these skills, learning to do translation, etc. Some of them go to graduate, postgraduate degrees for them to be able to do it. So we got them through a lot of tests and a lot of ways in which we make sure that these people are aligned with our values and at the same time also know the profession. And one of the kind of the challenges with Arabic translation goes back to the kind of the statistic I mentioned, is that a lot of scientific vocabulary is not available in Arabic because of the lack of scientific research in many of those countries. So if you think about we do have a group of advisors in countries like Afghanistan is actually worse. So in a way, it's like makes Iraq look like the Switzerland by comparison to Afghanistan, because like some languages like Pashto mainly been used for agriculture and things like that. So there's almost nothing about anything resembles Enlightenment philosophy and so we relied. I mean, after the Afghanistan disastrous withdrawal, there were a lot of people, professors at the University of Kabul, American University of Kabul, who's been lending us advice on like how to invent a word and where to, because again, like in languages like Pashto, there's almost nothing for a lot of the terms that we take here for granted. So that's really one of the extra challenge when it comes to translating these languages, when you're translating mainly like nonfiction and scientific materials or philosophical, because the terminology is not there for it.
Faisal, I remember. So we actually recently translated Barry Weiss's book, How to Fight Anti-Semitism. But you mentioned to me that the word anti-Semitism doesn't really doesn't translate very well in Arabic. Like they had to.
Yeah, because it's common sense there. No, right, just kidding.
Yeah.
But anti-Semitism is a Western terminology to describe, because supposedly the Arabs and the Jews came from both Ishmael. They have the same ancestors, so they're both viewed as the same people. We don't use the term Semite for. However, I mean the right word actually. There's a very interesting story about the Barry Weiss book because of the fact that anti-Semitism and many of these things are very common in the way in mainstream culture, is that the book publisher was like, okay, I cannot publish that book. Like, I cannot print it because that's just like it's a death sentence, really, just to print that book. That's like 2 months after, I think, was it 2 months or 9 months? Two to three months after an author was killed for publishing a positive book about Jewish history in the Middle East. His name is Masa Latif. I mentioned him in my event with Barry. And so it was like, I'm not going to be able to publish the book physically, but I'm going to do, we have underground book reading clubs that we meet in which we actually discuss many of these books that are not allowed to be said and published out loud. And he's like, I'm willing to do that. And that's the kind of the, especially when the subjects of anti-Semitism and things like rise, generally you get the accusation that you're working for Zionist and you're working for like Israel and things like that. And in many countries in the Middle East, that's considered treason. So treason, the punishment is death. So as a result, there is very little conversation about these subjects. Even though now it's much, much higher, especially after the Abrahamic Accords, in which the Arab governments now are pushing against.
Could you talk a little bit about, you know, when we talk about the Middle East, and certainly in the U.S., a lot of times it's just this kind of vague blob that we can kind of identify on the map, but where are the places that are more receptive to kind of, and I don't want to say Western values, because, you know, the West isn't particularly good at a lot of this either, but things like pluralism, tolerance, freedom of speech, what are the places where you guys are working in the Arabic language world that are most receptive to what we might call liberalism?
It's actually the places that don't really enforce the law very well, ironically. You know, if you the places that quite regularly censor stuff, like have a very long list of, you know, import controls and like just pressures on publishers would be like Egypt, Syria, Iraq, for whatever reason. I think they don't really enforce the law. So that's why it's a bit more of a wild, wild west. And you know, black markets are huge in the Arabic world, and not just for books, anything that, you know, that's banned. It's non-halal meats. It's like underground strip clubs, right? Like things like that.
Underground, like, strip clubs?
Yeah. Yeah, this stuff exists, like, you know.
Yeah, I mean, Melissa is absolutely right in terms of, the more there is less kind of government control. However, when there's less government control, means there's more militias. So that's where things are a bit chaotic. But also because of less government control means more freedom of speech. So that these are where things are kind of, when the government is busy fighting the militias and things like that, in the way they don't have the time really to enforce. Even though the Iraq constitution, for example, has restrictions on things that are ruining social cohesion or things like that. Same with Lebanon and other places. In terms of, I mean, the only country that's kind of institutionally, I would say, more prone to liberalism is Tunisia.
Mm-hmm. Which is also the ground zero in the Arab Spring.
Yes.
Right.
And that's, and to some extent, is actually the result of effort like us. The Tunisian, actually the dictator at the time, Bouteflika, established a translation movement mainly to translate French material, because Tunisia and North Africa tends to be closer to France than us, which is more, we're under the British control. And the more French-controlled occupied territories in North Africa, there were translation efforts to bring kind of French ideals to these nations. And one of those countries that were succeeded is Tunisia, where actually they have at least in principle, they have a version of La Cité, which is a secular belief, and also the fact of, I mean, kind of, we can make comparison between a French constitution and the U.S. constitution in terms of the Bill of Rights. And so they have some of that. That goes back and forth. But that's like the only country where it's been institutionalized, in which like we can call Western or Enlightenment thought. But the countries where it's not, where I said the chaotic countries, I find them to be actually the most, where there's going to be the most revolution. Saudi Arabia, to their credits, is actually evolving to some, again, it's like their people can pick and choose of social liberalism. I mean, you can have the economy without the freedom of speech, and you can, so it's not everything. So it's like there you just pick and choose which one you want. And some of the countries there like, try to pick like some things like economic liberalization, but not much on the freedom of press. So it's, there is a lot of nuance. It depends on which country is more. But even Saudi Arabia is progressing, I would say, towards more social reform, at least.
You guys are also, you have over the past year since the withdrawal in Afghanistan, I guess you've started operations in Afghanistan. Can you talk a little bit about what you're doing in Afghanistan and how that's working out?
We're doing a few things. So we've expanded into kind of trying to find journalists in Afghanistan, especially the ones, you know, left behind who are still able to tell stories. Because, you know, we see cultural exchange as a two-way street. It's not just about getting books in English, translated into Arabic so that they can read Western authors. But it's also the other way. There are stories, you know, there are things going on in that part of the world that we need to know about. And, you know, we've now moved on to the next current thing, and the press is no longer interested in what's going on in Afghanistan. It's Ukraine and Russia, or it's, I don't know, Will Smith's slap at the Oscars, whatever, whatever,
you know,
it is.
We do have priorities here.
Exactly. Oh, it's not, now it's the Will Smith. No, now it's the Johnny Depp Amber Heard trial, probably. That's the current thing. But
will you be translating that into Arabic? I hope, because then we want to have
to talk
about it. I think
that happens
English,
all
right?
The time, yeah, there, but in the other, yeah, way.
So what are you, you're finding journalists in Afghanistan and bringing their work to a Western audience?
Yes.
You're also working with girls' schools, right? Could you talk about that?
Faisal can.
Yeah. So we're working with anything underground, and mainly with the,
but mostly
the weather
strip
on the
clubs,
ground,
right?
Yeah. That's going to be that's the new program I'm discussing, yeah, right now. But the main thing is, I mean, when we started is actually been helping people getting out. So me and Melissa were involved in a lot of conversations to how make that happen. But the
evacuations.
But the main thing we're doing is, other than hiring a lot of these translators who were left out by the U.S. withdrawal, is that we are funding a lot of underground schools. So as you know, the not elementary, post-elementary schools right now is banned for girls across Afghanistan. The Taliban, which is supposedly now, they said they're, just FYI, just to talk about U.S. foreign policy, the disastrous one, is that the group that negotiated in Qatar is not the same group that's rolling out of Afghanistan right now. So America was talking to the wrong people. So the people eventually end up being ruling is actually not the same people we negotiated with. So those people what we negotiated with said, oh, school's going to be open, girls are going to go to school, etc. The ones who actually were in control were like, no, the moment they are in power, no, we want to reinforce the same rules that they had before, when they ruled before 2001. So what I think one of the most powerful quotes that I got from there is I asked one of those teachers, I'm like, hey, why are you doing this? Like, you're putting a lot of your life at risk. I mean, I'm crazy enough to do it when I was 15, but you are like, have a family and things like that. She told me, it's like, Faisal, when you taste freedom and know what it's like, you want to give it to other people. And this is kind of the type of... the type of people that we work with and empower, because and unfortunately many of these people don't know how to navigate all of the bureaucracy and know how to fill a 50-page report and things like that. So they're teachers. There are people who, especially teachers, like in a country that's really devastated by war. When we are constantly supporting, we're actually expanding this program. At the beginning, we wanted to kind of test it, see how it's going. Mm-hmm. We're getting a lot of positive feedback, and now the goal is to really. I think education is, especially guest education, is one of the best ways to screw the Taliban. They have obsession with this. For them, it's like, they are authoritarians on steroids, and there's nothing bothers them more than girls' education, and we're gonna continue doing that until they get defeated.
I believe it was Christopher Hitchens who actually said the single best thing you can do to cure poverty is to educate women. Mm-hmm. And I think that's very true of what we're seeing in the Middle East. One of the other things that we're doing is also expanding the Wikipedia project, mm-hmm, into Pashto and Dari. So, you know, we've been translating. I think the official statistic is that when we first started, 17% of the Wikipedia pages that you read in English is available in Arabic. So imagine, you know, how small your knowledge sphere is. If you were reading something and tried to look something up on Wikipedia and all you had was just that subset of what we have. So that was in Arabic, and now we've expanded to do Pashto and Dari as well. And so Faisal always has this you know, he made always made this comment about how for what 20 years we were in Afghanistan mm-hmm. and we didn't bother to put in a Wikipedia entry of like women's rights or feminism in
we
Pashto
had
and
other
Dari.
Priorities
clearly mm-hmm. yeah
bad ones but
yeah what how does that work in a country like Afghanistan? What is the percentage of people who have internet access, probably mostly through mobile phones? Yeah. But you know, so how does, you know, who are the people who have that, and are they mostly in cities? Are they in rural areas? Is it, you know, how do you kind of figure that out?
So, funnily enough, like when we were in a lot of conversations, is even though I've never been to Afghanistan, I know more about Afghanistan than many people at the State Department, which is I guess shocking, but not really. And mainly, I mean, there are major cities in Afghanistan. The one that the U.S. or actually the people most familiar with is Kabul, the capital city, and that's where there is a high penetration of the internet. There's a significant education for the most part. And then the other one is Herat, which is the one closer to the Iranian borders. And that's also tends to have a significant part of the internet. The Pashto area is mostly in the south, and this is where most of the Taliban is from. So actually all the Taliban is Pashto, but there might have some mercenaries from other races that do some of the work. And that became actually a priority for us, is that in terms of language, the first language in Afghanistan is called Dari, but it's reality is Farsi, the same language spoken in Iran. And the great thing about Iran being a civilization and even that part of Afghanistan, so that part of the population is exposed to at least some segment of the population of ideas. The Pashto one is the one that's the most difficult, and that's the kind of the borders with Pakistan, and that's where really a significant amount of extremism. What's really interesting about the Wikipedia piece is that there is actually a heavy usage of Wikipedia Pashto, but there is very little articles on it. So what's interesting is like there are some languages in which the people don't know Wikipedia even exists and there is barely any traffic, but Wikipedia Pashto has a lot of traffic for the website, but really doesn't have almost any content about anything meaningful. I mean, they have a lot of, no one would be begrudging, but really the fact is that most of the, I mean, as Melissa mentioning, is that the things that they actually need, in my opinion, if I was the policymaker at the time, was the fact that they need exposure away of ideas away from their little bubble, and the fact they would need to be introduced. I mean, if there's a country that really needs pluralism, is Afghanistan. It's a very multicultural people of different ethnicities and different religions and subsects and stuff like that. It's really the center of the world, it's Central Asia, and so they're a country of multi-ethnicities, and they definitely need some a dose of pluralism, because the most of the conflict is about the fact some of it is religious, but actually a significant part of it is ethnic, and there are some groups want to take over the other, and so that's to some extent became a priority for us. And what's really a theme of all of our content is critical thinking. It's really just empowering people to think for themselves. Other than really just pushing content, the idea is how can we make people really think before, and that's
been how do you do that? I mean that's, you know, something people struggle with everywhere, right?
Yeah. But
like what is a text or what is a practice that you try to
make it simple? I mean, really I studied critical thinking in college, and really the idea is that it's to get people to really use to think to appreciate the concept of thinking, and not and understand more that you actually the easiest thing to fool is the human. Is really like there are a lot of tricks when you teach people the tricks of how they are being fooled, from how confirmation bias works and how hindsight bias works and all of these logical fallacies. And when you show, like, pretty much everybody is a victim to one fallacy or the other, and the moment you kind of communicate it in that way is that this is in a way your way to prevent yourself from being fooled. Like, there are so many sales tactics, all of that stuff. If you use just basic critical thinking, you're able to save yourself from a lot of nonsense that's on the, and everything. Everybody's trying to sell you something, and there's a lot of nonsense everywhere. So I think is that if you, we're teaching it in a very simple way. I mean, if our videos are very short, it's been like they've had, some of them actually have 3 million views, 2.5 million views. It's the goal is to really make it simple. That, and I think I think we should be able to. One of my dreams is that now that we have some success stories in the Middle East, you mentioned that it's something that needed overseas. I think we should use some of that experience and maybe could be useful in this country. But really,
we will welcome that. But let's talk before we get to. I want to talk about the End Banned Books campaign you're doing before we go to the audience. But first, let's do a little biographical sketch. Faisal, you talked a little bit about growing up in Baghdad. What was it like under Saddam Hussein? And your father was, I mean, he was not actively in revolt, but he talked to you about, you know, this guy's kind of nuts.
Yeah. So I was my dad was an orthopedic surgeon, which I guess was a plus and a negative, is that because doctors get forced to go to war and at the same time, there was 1991, there was a revolution happened in Iraq between the Kurds in the north and then the Shias in the south. And then the province that my dad grew up in was actually taken over by the militia that was actually revolt against Saddam Hussein. So he has a lot of stories about having to in a way work with both patients, and both of them are killing each other. And then after that, Saddam Hussein used chemical weapons and all forms of that to get rid of those militias. And so the Saddam that I grew up with, I mean, Saddam went through multiple phases, the first one being an Arab nationalist.
He went through the country western phase of Saddam.
Yes. And a non-binary Saddam. But yeah. The first phase was he was an Arab nationalist, that he was more of a secular guy. And then after that, after the Iraq-Iran war, he started the war with America. And then he made it a war between good and evil of Iraq being an Islamic state against the secular atheistic West. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason why we have the God is great in our flag. It actually was installed in 1991. It didn't exist before. It was a socialist. So talk about like the worst mix. Like you got the two worst ideologies, and then so the one that I grew up with was actually a very religious Saddam. So we actually had what I grew up in, like in Montessori school, etc. There was something called the Faith Campaign. Actually, the New York Times did a very good article explaining. If you search the Faith Campaign Iraq, you will see like the when ISIS came up. Actually, there were a lot of people who came as a result of the Faith Campaign, because then that was, in a way, like institutionalizing religion, a very specific sect, which is the Salafi Sunni Islam. And that eventually and that was kind of Saddam trying to prepare. So the Saddam I grew up with was actually non-secular. He was hyper-religious. He was hyper-Sunni. There were specific things that Shias can do or cannot do.
At one point he translated the Quran, or did an edition where he put his blood in the
ink? He wrote the Quran with his blood, which eventually, actually, that's one of my dad's secrets, that he wasn't able to read public. Like, so my dad at the hospital was seeing a lot of people donating blood, so it was actually not his blood.
Oh my God!
So he makes a big stink
about using his blood in the ink of the Quran, and it's not
no. Even so his even blood. That is fake news. So and then he started becoming a novelist at his last.
He has the best-selling novel in Iraqi history.
Yeah, which is
but you got to give it to him, right?
I mean,
people didn't have to buy that.
It's difficult, and he didn't study marketing either. Yeah. So and actually, that's another story. I mean, there's a lot of stories to share, but they actually forced that during the sanctions. The salary of even a doctor was like $3 a month. So they took a dollar of my dad's salary to get the shitty book, the novel. And then they forced another one. They took another dollar. And so, yeah, like the from my end, I mean, I grew up in the area where Saddam Hussein generals used to live in. So when the U.S. War happened, my neighborhood switched from that to Al-Qaeda within a second, because many of these people, after the disbandment of the Iraqi army, so my neighborhood moved from a purely residential kids playing soccer stuff into an area where Zarqawi and later Al-Qaeda used to chill out. And my neighbor was actually, I guess it's like he was playing all sides. So one day he's with the Americans, the other day it was Al-Qaeda. So you never, and most, like what I think was very scary early is that Saddam first, and then after that, is the militias, is that they make you fear your own best friend. So one of the reasons why actually I ended up on a death list was my colleague in high school was the one who reported me, who was his cousin was a member of Al-Qaeda or some of his relatives. So in a way, it's like you have to like talk about cancel culture on steroids, or is that you have to constantly fear what you're saying. That's why like when I'm here, I'm always very expressive, because that was like a luxury to be able, because you never know that you might end up on the wrong list. And with the same with Saddam Hussein, it was more institutionalized where he had like out of four adults, one is in the intelligence services. So there are even rumors of like people getting divorced because they thought that their wife is part of the regime, or their husband is part of the regime, or their best friend is part of the regime. So like it's authoritative, it gets into your head. Like after, I mean, my parents in a way, like who lived a lot of decades in this regime, and so as many people, is like for them is like they're traumatized by like it's authoritarianism like on their brains. Like it gets to your core, in which everybody is have to be freak out of everybody. You never know if this person is a terrorist. You never know if this person is part of the government. And then when that regime was removed, it just became absolute chaos, because like people were living in a prison, both a real prison because they're not allowed to leave the country, and at the same time a mental prison. And so this is like the conditions in a way. I mean, I'm hoping I'm doing a good job in explaining it, but it's a bit harsher than actually what I'm saying. So this is the conditions in which like there are millions of people, tens of millions that grow up under. And then it's like when you look close by, look to Syria and things like that, it's a lot of similar stuff. Like when I been to Syria and talked to a lot of Syrians, that they say, "Oh, I can relate to you." I'm like, "Shit, that's the worst thing to relate to."
You used heavy metal music as a way of speaking back or speaking through this. Could you just touch briefly on what you got out of that? Because heavy metal people almost everywhere are reviled, right? They're a subculture. They're seen as weirdos.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'm in that category too. So as a result of this kind of authoritarian culture and regime, so like there's the both of them, there was kind of the rise of the counterculture, and the kind of the metal scene. I mean, for good and bad, it was viewed first as like Satanist, right? So that's like the worst thing that the religious hate. And at the same time, lyrics wise and things like that was always about kind of a screw to the outside world. That's why they scream so much, right? So then there was, I mean, with that actually get associated a lot of like intellectualism. So when there is kind of heavy metal underground concert, there is also books being discussed. And so all of these things are merged together in a context of, there is this mainstream culture, which is kind of flippy. One day, especially in my neighborhood, it was like one day with Iran, the other week with Al-Qaeda, and then people keep switching. So that's the mainstream culture. And then there is like this kind of community that really is against all of that. And that's where kind of the metal music and really the expression, artistic expression of the revolt. And actually National Geographic did a very good documentary on some of my friends. Mm-hmm. It's called Heavy Metal in Baghdad. Right. And you can see like some of these underground places I'm talking about. And it was young me like this. I guess I was in a heavy metal festival in Germany, and there's all these Germans, the big ones, and I was with this guy. And so I definitely lived, I'm enjoying it still, but there's all this. Now, actually, just to relate to all of what we're saying, is like kind of libertarian, classical liberal, whatever you identify with. But I will say like the anti-socialist, anti-theocratic theme is now the kind of the counterculture. So now there are like bookstores, and that's where like some of the bookstores that I met.
So we're looking forward to you translating AC/DC. You're done with John Stuart Mill, who obviously would have been a metalhead, right?
Yeah, I mean, to your surprise, like these things are so available right now. Is that? I mean, AC/DC is not really metal. It's like rock. Yeah.
It's really acoustic band.
Yeah, I mean, let's be exactly
it's folk music, really.
It's like more like a background music for me. I need more. But Yeah, I mean, all of these things, there's even now like local metal bands in Syria and all of that. It's in, and add to that is that now this kind of, there's even like an Iran club in Syria. I mean, not necessarily the best example to some people, but it is definitely, because again, it's like they, and part of the reason why they relate a lot to like kind of the Enlightenment era, I was having a conversation with a book publisher, is that like the Enlightenment era came during religious wars, right? It came during all of that. And that's what's really happening in the Middle East right now. So even though some of the language in the books of Voltaire and Rousseau and stuff is kind of difficult to comprehend in 21st century language, but in a way it's far more relatable than like the culture wars here in America, or even though they made their way to the Middle East, which just one example before, is that there was this school that was built, and it was like, it's a girls' school, but it says for people who identify as girls. And people there have no fucking idea what that means. Yeah. Like, what does that, like we're talking to the Middle East and people there. So like, so the people actually don't know how to translate this. So definitely the culture war in America have made it over there. Yeah. But people were very confused.
Melissa, talk about, you're from Singapore, and your father was, who's recently deceased, sorry for your loss, but he was also highly placed in the government. What was growing up in Singapore like? Because it's an authoritarian country, but distinct from a kind of what Faisal was talking about in Iraq.
I mean, very distinct, because it's a benevolent dictatorship. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, my childhood couldn't be more different from this guy's. The one thing we did share in common was the lack of freedom of speech, which is, you know, what he described as the weight of censorship on your shoulders, to always walk on eggshells, to not be able to really speak your mind. And I think the most pernicious end point of that is when you start to self-censor. And that's what happens growing up there. But by all accounts, it is very prosperous. It is a very stable country. Life is good, you know, especially considering what goes on here in the U.S. is like very high crime rates. Singapore is kind of a paradise to raise children in if you value safety and stability and prosperity. So, I mean, in that sense, I have no complaints. But growing up there, you know, I joked before, and even though it's not that much of a joke, my dad was kind of, he worked for the Singapore government, in particular military intelligence, and he was Asian Dick Cheney. He, you know, justified all the time torture. And so, you know, I always had this banter back and forth with him. And so, you know, most people's
factory. I guess
that
means you really did clean your room when he told you to?
Yeah, I really did. But you know, most people's factory settings tend to be, you know, probably, well, here in New York, probably more on the liberal side, and then you kind of, you know, grow up and, you know, maybe exposed to different ideas. But for me, it was actually the other way. My dad was always was kind of a dyed-in-the-wool neoconservative. And so, you know, he justified a lot of the repressive policies of his government. And in Singapore, speech has always been very highly regulated, you know, under the guise of preserving social and racial harmony. And that's something that we're hearing a lot more today here in the U.S., where you have books that are censored for the same reason. The Adventures of Huck Finn, Dr. Seuss, recently, Ook and Gluk, you know, have been
The Adventures
off.
Of the Cavemen, exactly. Kung Fu Cavemen.
Exactly, the time traveling, which were removed for depicting certain racial stereotypes or you know, kind of, in terms of Huck Finn, is the same kind of reasoning. But
it's also, Singapore is a very new country, right?
Yes.
And, I mean, how does that factor into, what is it? I mean, you're kind of like second generation or third generation being born after Singapore
was independent. Kind of, yeah. Yeah, but it was a British colony for a very long time, and then it changed hands under World War II, was run by the Japanese, who took over. Then it went back to the British, and Singapore was like one of the only countries that have gained independence reluctantly. Like, it got expelled from Malaysia, didn't really want to be on its own. So, you know, most countries have this desire. I think if you look at number of countries in time, you only see that increasing because countries keep splitting up. Like in the last few years, we've seen South Sudan split from Sudan, East Timor split from Indonesia. So there's always been this kind of like self-determination, right? Like people.
But Singapore says no.
No, they didn't want to. And primarily because it was a very small country, didn't have natural resources. The founder of modern Singapore felt that it was better off being attached to Malaysia, being part of a federation, kind of like the United States, in a way.
And is that, it's partly because they're afraid of being taken over by either China or, as in the past, Japan.
Exactly. But
does Singapore give the lie, I mean, in your reading, to, you know, there's a broad Western belief, and Milton Friedman probably articulated this most famously, of saying that when you get a certain level of economic prosperity, political freedom tends to go, you know, tends to come into play because people who are wealthy want to be able to spend their money on the things they want. They want to live a certain lifestyle. Do you think that is likely to happen in a place like Singapore?
The reason I didn't view the rise of China in the same way that many in the U.S. foreign policy circles and even government did for, I don't know, decades, was precisely because I grew up there and I knew, or at least I've known this for a fact, that I've seen people achieve riches and you know, enjoy luxury, actually go the other way on freedom. They think that it's actually it actually harms a society overall. And it's not just Singapore. I think the Gulf states are also, you know, another example of a place where people have very high standard of living there. I mean, New York is really a shithole country compared to some of these places. If you go to our subways, and these, you know, what they want is not these abstract freedoms. It's very difficult to convince people of abstract freedoms, like freedom of speech and, you know, for example, Singapore also does not have freedom of press. So if you look at the rankings globally, it's 158th out of 180 in the world. So it's behind Afghanistan, Libya, and Russia. To be able to apply for to publish anything, you need to apply for a license. And recently they put out a bill called the Prevention of Online Misinformation and Falsehoods, which is the government can basically force, if you posted something on social media, can force you to apologize, retract, clarify, which basically sounds like, you know, we're not far from it either, right? With the Ministry of Disinformation, it's going there.
Yeah, they're going to start saying, like, you have to stop using filters on your Instagram, and you're not really that skinny. You have to
That's
show your body mass or something.
That will help a lot.
Well,
in my case.
Let's talk about End Banned Books, the campaign that you guys are doing, because that, you know, is coming out of that. Could, I mean, that's Melissa, just to push a little on that, I mean, that seems like a ridiculous statement to say that, you know, the stupid thing that the DHS in America just announced and screwed up the announcement over the weekend. Like, they were trying to talk about, we're going to do this, but then they didn't even actually reply to the Associated Press and other places who had asked what you were going to be doing. But that kind of thing, to the type of censorship that you're talking about, or what Faisal was talking about, can you explain the link that you worry about in that kind of behavior?
I think I want to make a distinction. There really are different levels of censorship. In Faisal's country, if you say the wrong thing, you get killed. That's one level of censorship. That's one level of cancel culture.
Wait, and he's an American citizen now.
Okay,
so
sorry.
Are you talking
about old country. That was a microaggression.
Yeah.
So I need to be sent to the gulag.
Yeah. Okay.
Microaggression, sorry. But, you know, in Singapore, if you had said something that disrupted social or religious harmony, you would be at most jailed. So no killing, at least. So better.
But that is still insane.
Insane. Right. Okay. But in the United States, the manifestation of censorship and cancel culture are totally different. The consequences are different. Your First Amendment protects you at least from the government. But what you have is censorship at even different levels. To not have a book at a library is very different, you know, from not having a book published to begin with, because the publisher decides to retract it, as is what happened with Dr. Seuss's estate very recently.
And the Dave Pilkey books.
If
you have kids, or if you were a kid, you might remember him as the author of the Captain Underpants series.
Also highly censored.
Which was always being challenged in libraries. Yeah.
Yeah. And so, you know, in the US, the ALA, the American Library Association, puts out these, like, you know, lists of highly challenged books. Some of them are surprising every year. Like, I think Harry Potter is one of the most challenged books because of witchcraft and promoting Satanism.
Well, he
Satanism
never should have ended up with Ginny Weasley. Come on.
That's
all I think we all agree on that.
I mean, we all, I'm sure, have, you know, a sense of, like, if I was a censor, I would definitely, you know, prohibit 50 Shades of Grey. That's just a crap book. It shouldn't be in existence. We all have some sense of, like, what we would censor. But I think, you know, whether or not a book is in a curriculum, whether or not it's in a school library versus whether or not it's in a public library, it's very different. Yeah. And when you register a complaint, when you challenge a book, what you're doing is actually depriving other people of actually reading that book. It's one thing for you not to read the book. It's one thing for you to, you know, tell your children or to guide your children and be there when they're checking out a book. But it's another thing altogether to say, like, I don't want anybody else to read it. And I think that's where the danger and the parallels to cancel culture really come in. And let's be honest, some of these challenges that are going on right now in school libraries, debate on you know, whether or not these books should be removed, who is it really going to affect? Like, three Asian kids who go to the library? Like, who else is in the library? They're all on TikTok. Like, it's not even an effective strategy now. You know, like they're just getting their information elsewhere. So I don't even think
maybe
it's
you guys can start translating Dr. Seuss into English and distributing it for free in grammar schools around the country. So, talk about, I mean, the endbanbooks.org site is really kind of spectacular, and you jump from, kind of ridiculous examples, including the way Winnie the Pooh is banned in China, to more, I mean, I guess that's not inconsequential. The reasons for that are ridiculous, right? That Xi has been, people make fun of him and say he looks like Winnie the Pooh. So Christopher Robin takes it on the chin there. But what is the progression from the kind of banal examples that we might be talking about here to the more, you know, serious stuff?
Yeah, so endbanbooks.org, which I recommend everyone here goes there, is an advocacy campaign really to educate people about global censorship and also really the spectrum in which this censorship is. There are, I think, and that's really my personal belief, and there's a letter that I've written on really kind of tried to compare between all the examples, is that the impulses of authoritarianism, I mean, we've always had a history of that. And from the beginning of human history, there was this impulse to regulate speech and to regulate thought. And it takes different forms. And I think that the example that I grew up with, which is like one out of four, is in the intelligence services. And in a way, if you think about it, it's kind of very similar to some extent when you are a minority perspective in a city like New York City, in which the outcome is still negative. I mean, there's obviously these degrees of negativity. However, that kind of extreme version, I think, and that's, I don't think I'm being far-fetched here, is that I can definitely see the roots of authoritarianism over here in terms of people intolerance to different perspectives. The fact that other people, I mean, I've studied a lot about civil wars and I lived in one. And the first thing of civil wars is that you dehumanize the other group. That's the first instinct. After that, everything is permissible because you're going to act on self-defense. And you can definitely see roots of it over here in terms of kind of Republican, Democrat, et cetera, et cetera. The great thing is we have a rule of law and there is the NYPD. Let the NYPD take a 1 week break and let's see what happens. I'm not surprised if America will snap like this. And then what happens is that bad guys, a very small fraction of bad guys going to start killing each other. And then because of tribal nature, people will be like, at least he's better than the other side. And that's the same thing that we should, when you talk about censorship, you always get, well, if you are talking about the censorship from the left, like the knee-jerk reaction is, well, how about the right? They do this too. And then it's like, so you can definitely see that the seeds for authoritarianism and tribal thinking is already taking roots. So when we show the kind of the extreme examples of is that we're trying to educate is like, be careful what you wish for. This is the end. The civil wars and the censorship and the Minister of Information and the intelligence services, JSQ. This is like the most extreme. But this goes from a spectrum. I mean, in Europe, there's actually far more regulations of freedom of speech, and some of them are actually very stupid, and they are also trying to use force in terms of you saying the wrong thing, and. So there, if you take the spectrum of like, I don't know, Afghanistan being the most extreme in which girls don't go to school and books, pretty much all books are banned to some extent in Afghanistan. And during Iraq, during Saddam Hussein was, there are more books that are banned than are books that are read. So that's Iraq prior to 2003. So this is like the most extreme example. But if you always ask questions like, the people there are not special. Like, how did they get there? Everything that they get there is can evidently happen in places where it goes from freedom into authoritarianism. Mm-hmm. So really, I think there is a great message in this advocacy movement and this project that actually mainly targeted towards the West, which is be careful what you wish for and really educate them about the effects of censorship and the intersection between censorship and authoritarianism. Because I think many people here don't get that. Mm-hmm. And they think that even the subject of misinformation and combating misinformation, that's how many authoritarian regimes start censoring, is that it's always a slippery slope. They start with this, it never ends there.
In your experiences, never ends. In your experiences, was it also, you know, part of the way kind of a new wave of censorship is going through here is that it is about helping people who feel marginalized by discourse. So the reason we want to regulate Twitter is because one group is going after a marginalized group and saying bad things about them. So it isn't that we want to shut down speech and thought. It's that we want to protect, you know, marginalized groups that will leave the public square because they're being chased out. Is that the experience in places like Singapore or Iraq, or is it more fundamentally about we want to have a unified kind of identity and we're just going to wipe people out?
I mean, I think that's always been the excuse. It's very easy to sell censorship to the public using safetyism, using, you know, this is going to be dangerous, the speech is dangerous, it's going to disrupt the stability that you know. But at the end of the day, it is also a tool for authoritarians to hoard power. Every strongman out there today is censoring. And that's why I think it's a misnomer. We call them strongmen, but how can they be strong when they're afraid of mere ideas? Like if you look at the long list of books banned in places like Russia and in China and the Middle East, it is long. And I think the value of kind of highlighting banned books is to look individually at all of these regimes. And I think it's revealing because it reveals kind of what are their anxieties. When you look at the list of titles that are banned, for example, during Pinochet's Chile, the book that was
I'm going to go out on a limb and say it was the Atkins diet book. he really gained a lot of weight over his time in power.
Actually, I did not know that. That's fat shaming. But
yeah, in this case, it's warranted.
But, yeah. But the book that was banned at the time was a book called How to Read Donald Duck. Mm-hmm. And it was a book that was a Marxist critique of Disney, right, as a vector for exporting American corporate and cultural imperialism. And that book was banned by the Pinochet regime. So you can see kind of like the anxieties of these rulers that have authoritarian impulses.
So before we open it up for audience Q&A, Melissa, I have to ask you then, what is your anxiety about 50 Shades of Grey that you were calling for it to be sent?
It's a terrible book. Like, it's just awful.
Oh, it's the writing. It's terrible.
And it's just embarrassing that this exists and that women like it. I'm embarrassed for my gender.
Faisal?
I mean, it's hard to go from there to what I'm going to say. Yeah. But I mean, I'm going to say something. Gosh, that's a... make it difficult, but I just want to like remind people of what the Enlightenment is. I mean, the Enlightenment came in as a principle that you as an individual matter, and you have the ability to trade, and you have the ability to think for yourself. And there are a lot of people who don't like this idea, and we have to defend it in any way we can and stand for all of the values that this era that it came in from the Enlightenment era and set for it today, whether through translation, making it available to other people, and also if it needs to stand for this value over here, that I thought a country that get this shit together, I will do the same. So thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Nick.
Let's have some audience questions. Please wait for Malik to bring the microphone to you. Okay. And if you want to, you can identify yourself or you can use a pseudonym.
Hey, Faisal. My name is Arfab, and I'm from Pakistan, actually. And the question I have is regarding the books when you translate, you know, like I also send these books to Pakistan for kids to read, whatever. And there are much fewer institutional and legal constraints there, you know, and actually a lot of these books I buy in Pakistan because they're cheaper. But it's hard to have people read them because they don't resonate with them. They are so far removed from their cultural, moral, historical, whatever framework they have, you know, their Welt and Chong, that it is just very alien to them. You know, how do you, and I like the idea that you have like simplified translations of, well, like Pashto, for example, you know, but how do you get people to, is that like something that you struggle with? That's the first. Second mm-hmm. question I have is actually is a more political, and I wanted to ask some Iraqi, and I don't know any. You're the only one. Like, how do the
I'm going to be the prime minister, official okay, yeah. prime minister.
Quickly, you're
yeah, very yeah. good. Like, how do the Iraqi people feel about the U.S. and the war after all these years? Yep. What's their perception? Thank you.
I'm going to answer this very quickly. It all depends who you ask, but mainly, if you go to the northern part of Iraq, the Kurdistan region, it's generally tend to be very positive. If you go down, everything goes downhill. So the I mean, there were times in the northern part of Iraq in which the U.S. didn't have to go with any arms and they can walk around. In terms of, I mean, Pakistan, I mean, as you're familiar, there are blasphemy laws in Pakistan and that people end up if they convert to different religions or things like that. So there's definitely a lot of institutional restrictions on thoughts. And the for I think it's like when I was talking about the kind of the Enlightenment era, it is in a way a lot of relatable. Like, for example, one of the very, I think one of the most viewed articles this month in our work was the 33-year war, the one in the Protestant and the Catholics in Europe. And it happened because like one of famous blogger, and I think it was in Syria, tweeted about this, which is like, now we're having our phase of the 33-year war. Again, European example, Protestant, Catholic, Christian. Most people don't know what Christianity even have different sects. But it was relatable. Like they can see that there's some example there. We have a specific program in addition to the fact that creating relatable content of actually highlighting Arab liberal thinkers, which is called Bil Arabi, which is a semi, which is like liberalism in Arabic, but we all made it Bil Arabic, which is funded by Atlas Network and Friedrich Naumann. I saw there's Atlas people here, so big fan. And the idea is that we actually highlight people from the region who believe in these ideals, not just translating, but rather have people who really made their own thinking using local examples and be familiar with the nuances of the region who can explain it in a much better way than a translation ever would.
Thank you. Next question.
Hi, it's Debbie here. Thanks for the shout out to Atlas.
Hello, Debbie.
Hi. So I have a double barrel question as well. One is, what is your reach? Like, for example, do you know how many copies of On Liberty have been downloaded? And then secondly, are a pre-cleared, pre-translated classical liberal texts translated to Pashtun and Arabic of value to you?
So again, you want to jump in or you want me? Yeah, so Atlas Network has funded a lot of translations of classical liberal material. So actually we share, we have them in our library because we have a very massive reach. I mean, our page library website itself has 1 million followers. And then we acquired, because of my connections, we acquired a lot of connections of pages, social media pages that have now 6 million followers. So our reach in terms of people is 7 million. In terms of countries, Egypt, Morocco, Algeria, Iraq, and Lebanon, I think are the top 5 countries for in terms of and yes, we have measurement in our website about people downloading. And I would like to actually get in more, because what I'm also interested to know what sticks. in terms of the one of the people from Atlas, Noah Al-Harmouzi, you probably are familiar with it, from Morocco. He actually like explains the free market in very simple terms. And his podcast, the one we did with him, was the most viral one. It had like 500,000 views. So that was kind of like, oh, okay, let's highlight more people like that. So we do our best to actually see the data and what really sticks and try to make it as simple as possible. Because the ideas of freedom, as you all know, tend to be very abstract, tend to be had a lot of connection, especially when you have really no experience of freedom, especially many people have lived their entire life in authoritarianism, and for them, freedom is something they see on YouTube. So we really want to do our best to kind of like make it as simple as possible and see what sticks and work on that.
There's a brainwashing aspect to get over too, because I think not only is freedom abstract, but it's also tainted by these education systems and their governments, that freedom is a Western concept and anything that is Western needs to be derided. So there is that hurdle that we need to kind of cross. And then the other issue is also that I think when we start circulating books, like ebooks on Telegram, which is how the black market operates in the Middle East, we can't really track how far that goes. So once we can track like downloads on a website, but in terms of Telegram itself, like how far that actually spreads, like once it's on Telegram, it's just, we want it there, but you know, we
can
don't know.
I follow up a little bit on this was touched on briefly, but you know, overall in the Middle East and in Central Asia, and these are obviously distinct regions and there's lots of sub-pockets, but you know, the American foreign policy has been disastrous. It did not achieve its stated goals, you know, for all of the 21st century. I mean, is that also a stumbling block in terms of, you know, if you're saying, and now from the people who just bombed and occupied you for 20 years and then left, leaving many of you behind, here's a book about freedom. Is that a hurdle to overcome? I'm asking because this is, we don't hear really, you know, American foreign policy debates are always about domestic politics, really. We don't really hear from the people in the regions, you know, for good or bad that we interact with.
Well, I just came back from the region, and really the main thing that I think America lacks is trust right now, especially mm-hmm. after the Afghanistan withdrawal, in which many people now look at America as a really bad ally. With China, with Russia, you know what mm-hmm. they're gonna get. Like, you know, so if China makes a policy, Russia makes a policy, they stick with it. They stood with Bashar al-Assad and they defended Bashar al-Assad to death, and here they are. And he's still in power. With America, it's like, it's non-binary, really. It's like one day you are with this, the other day you are with that. Hillary praises the Arab Springs. The next day she's saying that Mubarak is our ally. Mm-hmm. So in a way is that the U.S. is definitely viewed as a non-trustworthy ally. The interesting thing also about the U.S. is that U.S. also has Hollywood and has things like that in which it exports its culture. So generally, people are familiar with America, not necessarily from a political standpoint. Mm-hmm. And that's said about Iraqis, in which we see the U.S. Army, but at the same time, we see Seinfeld. So in a way, it's like there is the export of American culture that sometimes is positive and is viewed. So if you ask most people, they will tell you, it's like, I like American people, not the American government.
I think the
policies they have about them, the government, is completely justifiable, especially after the whole disaster.
I'm assuming that the soup Nazi is the most popular Seinfeld character in Iraq, from what you were saying.
No, we need to translate it,
yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. Okay. Let's have another question.
Yeah, I guess more on the state of things in the USA. My husband is from Hong Kong, and I hear grave concern from our friends there. Their democracy has recently been crushed by the Chinese Communist Party. And my Hong Kongese friends say to me, are you aware that you're poised in your country to vote away your democracy, to vote away your freedoms, that we're very close to literally voting away something so precious and unique? And do you share their alarm?
I absolutely do. I mean, Hong Kong is, I don't know, it's a jewel, honestly, a beacon of what, you know, I mean, I think it's just such an important natural experiment, because people always said, I mean, the Communist Party always said, you know, how can you know, that democracy wasn't suited for people of Asian culture and Asian descent. And Hong Kong and Taiwan are just natural rebuttals to that argument. And Hong Kong flourishes in so many aspects of freedom. It was at some point in the 70s and 80s and actually early 90s, just, you know, produced the best movies anywhere. Like, they were outproducing Hollywood for a period of time, and their stars were just cultural phenomenons in their own right. And of course, today it's so sad. Like, you look at someone like Jackie Chan, and he has to pay lip service to the Communist Party, and, you know, now he just has to be fully on board the C train. To see Hong Kong kind of unravel in like right in front of our eyes should wake people up. And that it can happen so fast. It's not even a generation. It's like just a couple years that we saw, you know, the Communist Party just march in, install its lackeys as leaders, the new security law, and change the culture. I mean, remember the Causeway booksellers, the people who all the dirty tabloid criticisms of the CCP used to be published in this, in Hong Kong, because that was the only place that they could get airtime. And so, you know, the Communist Party is like millions and millions and millions of people that exist in the Politburo. And of course, it's not monolithic. There's internal dissent. There are people that, you know, that are publishing all these like internal dirty secrets. And the only place they would come out used to be Hong Kong. There was a book publisher, a very famous one called Causeway Booksellers, that used to publish all this stuff. They would annotate it and they would put out this material. And that was how we were getting intel on what was going on in the Communist Party. Some of it obviously is fake news, just like Twitter. It's just in book form. But you know, you got a sense of what was going on because Hong Kong was free. But, you know, not only was this guy, this bookseller, actually kidnapped whilst he was in Thailand. And by the way, he's not even a Chinese citizen. He's actually a Swedish citizen. So now Sweden.
I did not kidnap him. Why did you point at me?
I literally have no one in my place.
But yeah, to see kind of Hong Kong descend into that is really tragic. And the U.S., you know, as long as it does not value that the freedom of speech and the freedom of press, I think we'll go down that route as well.
How would you, you know, one of the things that comes up a lot is that Hollywood and the NBA, for example, because they're currying or cultivating a Chinese audience, they censor themselves or they restrict their players from talking. What would be a better response from America? Not in terms of, you know, military power or anything like that, but what would be a better cultural response?
I think it's just shame. You know, I mean, if you look at the actors, people like John Cena, who had to grovel and apologize in Mandarin. By the way, his Mandarin is really bad. It was embarrassing. But
in a way, that makes it better, right? He doesn't even know what he's saying, but he knows he has to apologize.
Right, but it's so cringe to see, you know, people who have money and status here in this country abide by the leverage that the Chinese government has purely because of market power, because they have to promote, in his case, was Fast and Furious 9. In the NBA's case, it's because the NBA has huge licensing deals in China. And it's not just the NBA. It's almost every company. Even Apple does it. Burton, the skateboarding company, does it. At the end of the day, market power is leverage. And the Chinese government knows how to wield it. They know how to get concessions and to get companies to abide by its political ideology.
We have time for one more quick question. Whoever gets the mic, can we come up here, Malik? Yeah, it's got to be a short question. It's got to be a question. No double-barreled questions. Three-part.
Hi. Go ahead. Melissa, can you comment in that context about Elon Musk buying Twitter?
I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. I think Elon is doing so many things that are good for society and advancing humanity, one of which, by the way, I think has the power to really disrupt authoritarianism around the world, and that is Starlink. Right? Like, to have satellites that can connect the world outside the confines that are controllable. Like, imagine Starlink versus the Great Firewall. We may have a chance to reach, you know, the inner recesses of the Chinese population that are right now, as we speak, revolting and rioting unprecedented, right? Like in Shanghai and Shenzhen against very draconian COVID policies. And to drag him right now because he has, you know, certain deals because of Tesla with the Chinese market, also lithium, he needs, you know, the company does need the rare earth materials that are only coming from China. And so he has to play nice with the Chinese government in some respects. I think the exposure is something that we need to keep tabs on. Like whether or not, if he owns Twitter, does the Chinese government have any leverage? I saw that recently that the state media person has actually requested Elon to remove, because Twitter says, if you are a spokesperson for a government, it says like state media. And so he requested Elon to actually remove something. They tagged him directly. I mean, I think it's up to us to keep tabs on something like that, to make sure that he is not kowtowing to the demands of the Chinese government. But otherwise, he is actually exposed. His business interests, his business deals leaves him, his companies, his IP exposed in China. It could end very badly for him. It could end very badly for Tesla. But I don't want to discount the other things that Elon is ideologically committed to, and that is free speech. You know, he did famously say he's a free speech absolutist. And also what he's doing with Starlink really has the potential to disrupt the censorship around the world.
All right, we're going to leave it there. I want to thank Faisal Saeed Al-Mutar and Melissa Chen of Ideas Beyond Borders. This has been the Reason Interview. Thanks for listening.
Thank you for being here, guys.